Good evening. Welcome to the first Stalin Memorial Lecture. It is unthinkable that anyone in Lithuania, having made a fortune from mushrooms, would set up a theme park devoted to Hitler. Yet this Baltic state's top man in canning, drying and trading Belitas, Chanterelles and Morels has founded Grutto Parkas, also known as Stalin World. What is it? A shrine to a despot? A memorial to his victims? A provocation? A witting joke? An unwitting joke? A test to stretch the limits of taste? Memento mori, a gesture of politically incorrect defiance? It's probably all of these. Although it makes no allusion to many Lithuanians having collaborated with Nazi Germany, it's also that least Stalinist of endeavours, an attempt to tell at least a partial truth about the past rather than to rewrite it. For Stalin, the past was whatever he and his battalions of airbrush operatives wanted to make it. It was as much a lie as the present and the future. The erased image presaged the erased life. Stalin's genocidal zeal was different to Hitler's in its aims and in the sheer randomness with which its victims were selected. The extent of its enormities was greater. Hitlerians are regarded as morally infirm. They know it, and they tend to keep their squalid infatuation to themselves. They're furtive, like paedophiles in jackboots. They're beyond the pale. Why then are Stalinists not beyond the pale? Why does Stalin's name not prompt the same revulsion that Hitler's does? We're selectively fastidious, selectively demonizing. It is apparently no solecism to express a sly admiration for Uncle Joe. Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother's riotous annual turn at the Sandringham staff's Christmas party, dressed as the mass murderer's mass murderer, never began to incur the level of censure that the mob visited upon her great-grandson Harry when the poor mutt donned a Nazi armband. Certain of the effects of tyrannies are quantifiable. The number of deaths achieved by pogroms, genocidal programs, famines, wars, forced labor, imprisonment. This is what the creation of a better world evidently involves. It involves easy things. Turning policemen into willing murderers. Turning the army against civilians. Turning crime into the rule of law. Turning fields into killing fields. Turning a country's soil into an ossuary. It is much harder for a state to use its power gently than to abuse it. During Stalin's regime, countless millions of people died, shot, poisoned, tortured, starved, frozen. Many died incredibly to meet the death quotas determined by the secret police, the NKVD, as a sort of sacrificial offering to the bloodthirsty tyrant. For no reason other than to satisfy the ogre in the Kremlin, who, in the words of Saint-Exupéry, murdered according to Marx. Joseph Stalin exercised something close to absolute power for a quarter of a century. This is the poet Osip Mandelstam, who died in captivity in 1938, having recited these now famous, then suppressed lines mocking Stalin. He recited them to less than a dozen people, one of whom turned out to be an informer. Every day someone is executed. To our barrel-chested Georgian, it's no more than picking berries. Was Vladimir Nabokov's contention that there is no such thing as Soviet literature? The compromised circumstances of its creation militated against it being anything more than propaganda to deceive the naive and to flatter tyrants. Tyrants are notably susceptible to flattery. Now, Nabokov's dicta are imperious, and his loathing of the Soviet Union was visceral. Witness his inordinate fondness for a tie which James Mason gave him. It bore the legend, "Fuck Communism." But he was the greatest writer of his time, and he remains, almost 30 years after his death, a tonic antidote to the battalions of fellow travelling apologists who deluded themselves that the stench of evil was sweet, who turned a blind eye to Stalin's crimes, and who excused them when they could no longer be denied. The roll call of these useful Western idiots is long and varied. For instance, H.G. Wells, George Bernard Shaw, who declared during one of the great famines that the USSR was the best-fed country in the world, and the Queen Mother's chum, James Callaghan, who observed after a trip to the repressive state of Czechoslovakia as late as 1960 that socialism works, whatever that means. It means that politicians in supposedly democratic states covet the license of free-range tyrants. So, can it be asserted with Nabokovian certainty that there is no such thing as Soviet architecture? There was certainly Soviet building, just as there was Soviet facial hair. Architecture differs from literature. No matter what the regime, architecture is dependent upon a client's patronage. All a writer requires is pen and paper. An architect requires a commission. Whether that commission is public or private, architecture is the result of a compact between creator and client. Architects have seldom suffered writers' persecution, but equally, they have seldom enjoyed writers' freedom.
And when the client is the most prescriptive and authoritarian of states, even that freedom is largely curtailed.
The compact is grossly unbalanced, for every despot considers himself an architect, the architect of a society, the architect of its buildings. Buildings were to be the expressions of the new world. Buildings were a means to forge a new form of mankind. Buildings were a tool of the social engineer, who would, of course, prevail because humans were potential clean slates for the state to draw its crude lines on. Humans who did not become clean slates might soon become ex-humans.
The act of building is a boast about the happy future that the state is providing for the people. The act of building is a manifestation of perpetual progress, eternal revolution. But most of all, the act of building is the physical, tangible expression of promise.
Jam tomorrow. To travel hopefully is better than to arrive. The Soviet Union was as much founded in the work of the 19th century poetic realists Lewis Carroll and Robert Louis Stevenson as in that of the 19th century prosaic fantasists Karl Marx and Frederick Engels. Anticipation, that's the thing. Anticipation of the ideal socialist state, which is just over the horizon. We're almost there, but quite.
The Russian word for an arterial road stretching into the distance is, tellingly, a prospect.
Meanwhile, let us breed white rabbits. Utopia, eventually. Because the dream is so much more potent than the actuality must be postponed indefinitely. Thus, the most grandiose of Stalin's projects was never realized. They were triumphantly announced. Competition upon competition was staged. Ever more ambitious drawings were published. The conditions of the brief would be altered to incite the winning architect to push himself higher, further. Yet the endless bureaucratic prevarication and the labyrinthine commissioning process suggests that these projects were never really intended to get off the ground. Consummation was inachievable.
They were as much a lie as heaven on earth. The peaks of Joe Building were, ultimately, myths of the future indefinite. Myths wrought not by architects, but by consummately gifted anonymous perspectivists, whose materials were paper and ink, rather than stone and steel. The fact that they were fictive does not detract from their reality. An object or person need not be actual to be real. Look at God, the devil, Anna Karenina, Eugene Onegin.
The highest peak of all, the Palace of the Soviets, would, at 1,300 feet, have exceeded every other building in the world. It was the living god Stalin's homage to the dead god Lenin, whose statue on top would have risen over 300 feet.
The cult of the dead god was not merely one of veneration. In Stalinist iconography, Stalin is modestly portrayed, simply another comrade. Nonetheless, there is no doubt that he's Lenin's earthly representative. Lenin is the father, Stalin is the son. Thus Stalin, although self-invested with absolute power, enjoyed an exculpatory device. Filial flaws could be ascribed to Lenin's example, just as cock-ups could be ascribed to saboteurs, acting on the orders of Trotsky, the Judas, who from his exile describes Stalinism as the syphilis of the workers' movement.
As a representation of the dictatorship of the proletariat, such architecture is laughable. As a representation of the dictatorship of the dictators, it could hardly be bettered.
Trotsky said that the years 1928 to 31, that is the years when Stalin had more or less gained absolute power, represented the bureaucracy's attempt to adapt itself to the proletariat. Put more bluntly, Stalin's cultural and architectural program was to seek an idiom which would appeal to idiots and illiterates, which was impervious to interpretation, which could be taken only one way. This is what totalitarianism means. The despot's ideal is a building which imprisons the mind without imprisoning the body.
Such a building offers no possibility of an alternative to its unequivocal message, which, like a church's, is an exhortation to credulous obedience and dependence. Stalinism was monopolistic, just as the church had been at the height of its power. It was the conduit of all knowledge to an ignorant, unlettered populace, the source of all learning. It was a means of programming and controlling the people.
In 1894, at the age of 14, the future Joseph Stalin, he was still Djugashvili and would not become Stalin till he was over 30, left his hometown of Gori to enter the Orthodox seminary and the nearby Georgian capital of Tbilisi.
He claimed to despise the church, but he would improbably have become the messianic tyrant he did without having suffered the seminary's regime of secrecy, searches, and informers.
Stalin claimed to be an atheist. He was religious. He believed so much in God that he murdered God in order to seize God's power and become almighty. Astonishingly, he succeeded. God was the greatest of his many victims.
Pascal wrote, "Men never commit evil so totally, so gleefully, as when they do so out of religious faith." God, so far as I can gather, is reached through faith, a low-grade form of learnt imagination. Imagination where someone else has done the imagining for you, but imagination nonetheless. To summon up the living God, no imagination is required. Imagination is rendered irrelevant. While Stalin was training to achieve his most unusual ambition, Tbilisi was booming.
And cities that boom, build. The adolescent Stalin, brought up in a shabby small town, saw a new city arise around him.
Its architecture made an impression on him. It determined his taste. A taste that would, subsequently, mutate into his empire's taste because it was his will. Tbilisi enthusiastically adopted Art Nouveau, which was not new. It was, rather, the last gasp of 19th century revivalism. Art Nouveau gives us an indication of Stalin's early thinking about the uses of architecture and its potential for politicization.
He cannot have failed to observe how the opulent buildings erected by the newly rich of Tbilisi were swiftly imitated by the poor. The poor aspire to be rich, and if they can't be rich, they'll ape the trappings of the rich.
Art Nouveau was a supreme form of maximalism. It was tabloid architecture. Importunate, loud, vulgar, easily understood, familiar, comforting, figurative.
The architecture of the early Soviet period was bereft of these qualities. Its abstraction and structural candor were revolutionary. Architecturally revolutionary, that is.
The equation of revolutionary art and revolutionary politics is naive in the extreme. Constructivism was Russia's particular version of modernism, which was routinely derided by its many detractors as international modernism, an epithet which deliberately echoed international capital, the derogatory code for Jewish money.
Modernism would gradually become internationalized, not least as a result of the emigrations enforced by those very tyrants who feared that internationalism would jeopardize the nationalistic purity that they sought to impose.
Tyrants are big on purity. This is the Lubyanka, where purity was taught. What most strains of modernism did have in common was a resistance to the literally representational. They also had foundations in painting and sculpture which celebrated the machine to the degree of wishing to appear machine-made.
More than any strain of Western modernism, constructivism was preoccupied by engineering's potential to create an architecture which had never previously existed, which was genuinely new. It was realized that engineering might be employed in the creation of a sort of counterintuitive structure which would overthrow the old architectural order as surely as the Soviet experiment had overthrown the old social order.
It further realized that engineering might serve ends other than functionalism, or that the functional and the fantastical could be the same. Anything was possible, so long as it broke with the past and shed the burden of history.
few projects got off the ground in the 1920s. After revolution, after civil war, there was economic chaos, which militated against building. And by the end of that decade, Stalin's power was absolute.
Eras which dispense with aesthetic caution are rare, because they're feared by authority, and authority would not be authority were its knee-jerk reaction not to inhibit artistic liberty whilst claiming to grant license. Dictators, by definition, abhor what they cannot control, what they have not dictated. So artistic or architectural revolution and political revolution are seldom happy bedfellows.
The masses are not to be won over by avant-garde experimentation, which is evidently exclusive, and which is, anyway, the endeavour of that part of the bourgeoisie which refuses to consider itself bourgeois.
By the early 1930s, modernism's radical programme had been quashed by Stalin's reactionary cultural revolution. Architects were warned of the dangers of uniformity, and modernism was declared un-Soviet. The constructivists had either emigrated or had swallowed their pride and had adopted the populist idioms that the state now sanctioned. The coercion of the proletariat can only be achieved by populist means. That is to say, by means with which it is already familiar.
Cakes and ale, bread and circuses, tabloids and pop music. Political revolutions will only succeed if they espouse aesthetic conservatism.
From the Renaissance till the Enlightenment, it was taken for granted that the classical orders, notionally based on human proportions, descended from God. They were invested with his authority because he had created the first human being, Adam, in his image. Whether or not an untutored populace appreciates this underlying conceit, almost certainly not, the apes of God have persistently resorted to classicism and to its variations like the Baroque, demob happy classicism, to embody their authority. Such authority was more willingly accepted, at least more easily exercised, in Hitler's Germany than it was in Stalin's Russia. Germany was a fraction of the size, was linguistically unified, was ethnically more or less homogeneous, save for Jewry, which provided the internal enemy which is the sine qua non of a dictatorship. The bourgeoisie fulfilled the same role for the Soviets. And then there is the German aptitude for ordered compliance. Russia, on the other hand, gave us Bolshevism and, hence, the word Bolshe, which signifies the very opposite of compliant. Many Russians were too Bolshe to subscribe to Bolshevism. Nietzsche's notion of the will to power stipulates that the majority who do not seek power enter into a submissive pact with those who do. But Nietzsche was a German. His observations were based in familiarity with the mores of his compatriots. Engels and Marx were also German.
The familiar question, could Marx have lived in a Marxist state? Only if the old shaman himself had been the despot, which is what he'd have wished. Despite his sentimental optimism about the proletariat, he was a paternalist. They cannot represent themselves, they must be represented.
Perhaps it was the wrong country that adopted Marxism. A country unsuited to it. Marx himself certainly thought Russia too backward, too agrarian, and too lacking in concentrations of population. Russia was certainly inured to despotism, but that did not make it an ideal testing ground for the comradely, hypocritical despotism of Bolshevism, which was described by the apostate Marxist Peter Struve as imported foreign potions mixed with native rot gut.
Of course Germans drink. Russians, however, overdrink.
Shelter, food and sex apart, the most basic human instinct is intoxication, the achievement of an altered state. In this regard, Russians are superhuman.
The Kremlin was a pissocracy. In his later years, Stalin was the people's piss artist, a sort of Oliver Reed gone to the bad. Incidents of vodka-fueled humiliation were routine. Men with the power of life and death over the planet's inhabitants were bartered night and day.
The Kremlin, a political, religious, martial, social compound, did not observe the 2-year-long prohibition of alcohol that it imposed on the rest of the USSR. And nor did anyone else observe it. It was unenforceable in a country whose populace will do anything to get out of its head, to seek oblivion. Russians will imbibe anything. Rubber, dentist alcohol, fertilizer, sortie, dry cleaning fluid, windscreen wash, glue, naphthalene, briz, shoe polish, metal polish. Reindeer. Heavily disguised reindeer, admittedly. Genetically modified reindeer. The hallucinatory fungus Amanita muscaria is so prized that two can be swapped for one reindeer. The fungus is dried, powdered, drunk. The drinker's urine is ingested because renal processing increases the toxin's potency and will increase it over and over again.
To many people in the north of Russia, this recreation was, understandably, preferable to compulsory participation in the Soviet experiment. Social utopia, no. Psychotropic utopia, yes.
New mankind needs new forms of habitation. At a micro level, this meant the horrors of collective living, of strictly apportioned space in apartments and houses requisitioned or stolen by the state, which now owned all property. At the macro level, it meant new forms of city, which caused a dilemma. For the city was, according to Engels, who had witnessed at first hand the conditions of England's 19th century industrial cities, an exclusively capitalist construction. Engels was, as it happens, wrong. It is unsurprising that Soviet Russia, forged in 19th century thought, should have been enthusiastic about the escapist late 19th century solution to urban problems, the garden city, devised by Ebenezer Howard, whose anti-urbanism was as virulent as Engels's.
The garden city was the sort of solution that bravely turns its back on the problem, buries its head in the sand, and attempts to start from zero. Ernst May was another German, the city architect of Frankfurt, where he had applied lessons in planning, if not design, that he had learned as a young man at Hampstead Garden Suburb.
He was invited to Russia to build entire garden cities. Stalin had ordered that 700 such settlements should be created. The first, the model for those which would come after, was to serve the steelworks of Magnitogorsk in the mineral-rich Urals.
A hell of noxious mills and toxic furnaces provided work for tens of thousands of people who subsisted in the most rudimentary accommodation. Tarpaulin barracks, tents, mud huts. It was the Wild East, a sort of pig iron Klondike. And there was also inevitably a forced labour camp. In that regard, it resembled Nazi Germany, but in its pollution and eco-hostility, it could not have been further away from that most green of regimes.
everything was against May: bureaucracies, budgets, builders, schedule, and his neglect to design for the harsh climate. But beyond these, there was the matter of his aesthetic unsuitability. It's bewildering that he was appointed. May's undecorated, uninflected blocks were denounced as unsuitable for heaven on earth, as examples of capitalism's patronisation of workers. This was how the West treated its workers, by giving them hutches, machines for living in. May was dismissed. He said later that he was lucky to escape with his life. The dictatorship of the proletariat scorned the architecture that had been high-mindedly devised to represent it. It demanded instead mock palaces. Here was the people's will in stone. The people's will was 16th-century Venice.
Thankfully, for their own sake, architects had throughout history been more than willing to bend to the will of the people. That's to say, to the will of dictators. Take Alexei Shusev. When he was 30, he was a vernacular pasticher. This convent is not medieval. It was completed only a few years before the revolution. He became a constructivist.
Soon after, he became a neo-Baroque decorator. Such lackey hacks abounded in Stalin's Russia, earning their Order of the Heroes of Ina Linguia First Class, accepting dachas and motor cars from the beast whose achievements they hymned. Now, such versatility was regarded with mistrust in the West from the beginning of modernism, because modernism was a sort of creed, an architectonic faith. But it was a faith that flourished in democratic societies. It was a manifest of artistic freedom, which its denigrators would do well to bear in mind.
A work of art or engineering, architecture or craft, made in a totalitarian state is a facet of that state, a glorification of that state. It is achieved by its maker obeying state thought, or, terrifyingly, second-guessing state thought, which in the case of the Soviets was capricious, ever-changing. Second-guess wrongly and you might forfeit your career, at least. A dictatorship has to suppress imagination, for it is the enemy of obedience. During a paper shortage, caused, of course, by Soviet incompetence, Lenin pronounced that paper used to print poetry was paper wasted.
Stalin was a different sort of Philistine. He approved of poetry so long as it was doggerel that praised him. O great Stalin, O leader of the peoples, you brought man to birth, you fructify the earth.
This is a creation myth.
No wonder he was furious when Roosevelt told him that he was known as Uncle Joe. It was an insult. It relegated him. A mere uncle? When you're the living God who spreads his seed to fructify, the literal father of the nation, who embodies the history of the nation, who personifies the nation, who understands its variety because he is, in his own words, a Russified Georgian Asiatic, an heir to Genghis Khan, to Tamerlane, a warlord of the steppe, an outsider to Moscow. Though to Le Corbusier, Moscow itself was the carcass of an old Asiatic village.
It's a common characteristic of rulers that they should be outsiders, immigrants from provinces or dependencies or semi-detached neighbouring states. One thinks first, of course, of Andrew Bonar Law, Britain's Scottish-born Canadian naturalised Prime Minister. One thinks of New Labour, which is entirely a Scottish construct. One thinks of Catherine the Great of Russia, who was German, of the Corsican Napoleon, of the Austrian Hitler. Maybe only an outsider can take a nation's temperature. This Russified Georgian Asiatic, Lenin called him simply Asiatic, understood a glaringly obvious point, which Lenin had ignored and which Trotsky denied. Namely, that this greatest and most terrible of social experiments, this experiment forged in 19th century thought, this experiment that he himself led,
was being conducted on the Russian people, and that it could only succeed if it took into account the Russianness of Russia.
The Eastern Orthodox Church could hardly have been more Russian, but it was sectarian and thus a rival to be quashed. One of the Council of People's Commissars' first acts, only 3 months after the revolution, although that date is necessarily approximate, was to abolish the Julian calendar. The Eastern Orthodox had stuck with the Julian calendar simply because it wasn't the Roman Catholic Church's Gregorian calendar, which even Protestant Britain had subscribed to since 1752.
So 13 days were famously lost, hence the anniversary of the October Revolution occurring in November. Where did those days go? People searched for them. They felt that they had been robbed, their life had been shortened. It was said that the days had been buried in a wood. But when you search in a Russian wood, you do not find days. Russia had broken with its past and had come into line with the West. It shared its measurement of time with what is now laughably called the international community. And so it remained till 1929.
This is when Stalin's paranoid isolationism began. This is when the rest of the world outside the Soviet Union effectively ceased to exist. That was the pretense, the delusion. So all tokens of degenerate capitalistic cosmopolitanism had to be annulled, tokens such as a shared calendar. But the Julian calendar could not be returned to because of its religious associations.
So the Soviet calendar was devised. It was based on a 5-day week. It caused such confusion that it endured for only 2 years before it was scrapped and replaced by a calendar based on a 6-day week. Under both these systems, there existed a denomination of time exclusive to the USSR. Here was Soviet time. It was unlike anyone else's time. It was nationalist, hermetic, insular time. These were the properties Soviet architecture would henceforth aspire to. Stalin, in his omnipotence, could amend the unities at will. He could change the very rhythm of life. He was more powerful than the moon's cycle. He could vanquish tides. He could control the elements. In a folk tale, a state-sponsored folk tale, of course, he altered the Earth's orbit. He was a greater force than nature. He created inland seas. His slave laborers died in their thousands, digging bloated canals more ostentatious than utility demanded. Their function was to prove the state's might. Like the great dams, they were feats of symbolic hydraulic engineering. The electrification of the USSR was so much a cause of enjoined nationalistic celebration that parents were encouraged to call their baby girls electrification.
It became a popular patriotic given name, along with barricade, metallurgist, oncologist, radiographer, slide rule, and galvanizer.
Like many autocrats before him, Stalin determined to control the climate. Unlike them, he partially succeeded through cloud seeding to ensure that the days of great parades were clear of rain. Apartments were given Italianate features, and ice cream was made widely available in an attempt to persuade Muscovites that their climate was Mediterranean. Weather modification was also a Nazi preoccupation, and one that the USA, inheritor of Nazi science, has covertly researched. It is, of course, a means of controlling the production of crops and, thus, population.
Infamously, Stalin had other methods of achieving those goals. There were the preposterous five-year plans, of which the first, self-congratulatorily, was achieved in less than 5 years.
There was the brutal communization of agriculture, which occasioned the unprecedented enforced migration of peasants into collective farms. 70 years after serfdom had been abolished under Tsar Alexander II, the Soviets, nostalgic for the perceived certainties of the 19th century, reintroduced it under another name. Beyond this measure was the murder of thousands of kulaks, the land-owning peasants who were calumnized as enemies of the people, even though most were little more than smallholders. But they were smallholders with just enough to eat and were thus condemned as bourgeois.
The mechanization of agriculture became a Soviet fetish. Tractors and combine harvesters were the tools and, more importantly, the symbols of a new agrarian order, an order which resulted in the most devastating famines, which were frivolously euphemized as problems of grain distribution.
One result of famine was cannibalism. Children were eaten by their own parents. Women craved pregnancy in order that they might give birth to food and that their lactate might be turned into curd cheese. I find that the recipes that are best adapted for cooking human are those normally applied to rabbit and pork.
These famines were on a biblical scale. They were, of course, man-made, like the majority of famines. They manifested the living God's wrath, or his negligent incompetence. He was aware of their extent, yet was appallingly indifferent to their consequences. Stalinism was bizarrely infantile. There is something infantile about anthropomorphic tractors and zoomorphic combines. There is something infantile about murdering any real or supposed enemy. It's the politics of the playground, conducted in the moral void of untutored childhood. Stalin had a webbed foot and a withered arm. He was a creature of terrible fairy tale. He built grotesque fairy tale castles, fit for murderous witches and monstrous ogres and creatures from nightmare sumps. A popular Soviet song of the years of the Great Terror included the line, "We were born to make fairy tales come true." Stalin was an invention of Lewis Carroll's come true, the Red Queen. Off with their heads. Only fairy tales which shun the constraints of naturalism can represent an enormity such as Stalin.
Starting from zero is infantile. Building a new world for a new form of mankind is infantile. What would a brand new world's buildings look like? The answer is simple. As with the calendar, so with architecture.
the buildings that Joe built are defined by what they are not. They are not the old world's buildings.
Yet they are not like those of anyone else's new world. Not modern. Stalin's buildings do not belong to any school of modernism with a capital M, though of course they were inevitably modern in the proper sense of that word. Whatever was created in, say, 1933 was at that moment modern, no matter what it appeared to be. Not Russian. Stalin's buildings are not Russian, even though they allude to a Russia that might have been. They are perforce Russian because Russia is where they are sited. Not Nazi. They are, God forbid, rather living, now dead, God forbid, not Nazi because totalitarian genocidal National Socialism was, of course, a world away from totalitarian genocidal Soviet Socialism. Hitler's moustache was nothing like Stalin's, although neither of the great dictators could swim. The desk murderer Heinrich Himmler had nothing in common with the desk murderer Lavrenti Beria. The one commissioned furniture made of human bones, the other merely raped prepubescent girls. They are not reactionary, not bourgeois, not capitalistic running dogs in bricks and stone because... well, because they're constructed in service of a regime which opposes reaction, bourgeois opulence, and capitalism's exploitation of its workers. Not, not, not.
Not, not, not.
Yet.
Not.
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 Not. Not. Not.
Not.
They're not American.
The Soviet Union looked enviously at American industry, hired American engineers, may even have pursued an inverted version of the great American dream. But nonetheless, officially, America was regarded with extreme suspicion. The architect of this world-class hotel was arrested after he was heard speaking English, which he had learnt in America. A chamfer lathe operator was imprisoned for having boasted of having owned a car when he lived in America before the revolution.
A Soviet skyscraper was deemed to exhibit different principles to an American skyscraper, an assertion that was made without qualification or explanation. The Soviet Union's borders were sealed. Not that its citizens could find them. The absence of detailed maps was a means of preventing escape. The soldiers who guarded the borders were regarded as heroes.
They were honoured for preserving the integrity of the state. The state could thus claim, among other things, to be culturally autonomous.
This was, of course, a lie, just as the projects which would never be built were lies.
The Soviet Union was a prison, which notoriously contained within it further prisons, like a Russian doll. But even the highest security prison is not entirely insulated against the world outside it. And anyway, Russian dolls aren't actually Russian.
They are originally Japanese and only arrived in Russia a few years before the revolution.
Stalin's architecture was not old, not modernist, not Georgian, not Nazi, obviously, not bourgeois, not Baroque, not American, not Asiatic. It was rather all of these things simultaneously. There is a dogged conviction that more is more, an absolute faith in muchism. It's as though a building's status is determined by the sheer quantity of disparate elements that it can incorporate. Elements which it hasn't borrowed, but which it has stolen. That is only appropriate for a criminal regime. Like a thief, it of course denies that it steals. Architectural plunder was one of its lesser crimes. The coarse amalgam of idioms is achieved with indiscriminate abandon. In this regard, Stalin's architects were strangely prescient. They anticipated the worldwide reaction to modernism in the 1970s.
So, Joseph Stalin, glorious godfather of postmodernism. That's not so far-fetched as it sounds. Sure, postmodernism attempted to make a virtue of levity. It was allegedly elusive, knowing, jokey, witty, and so on. But above all else, it was populist, often tiresomely populist. So much for the free market responding to popular taste. It took the free market over 40 years to achieve what Stalin achieved by decree overnight, namely, that architects should design for the people, not for other architects.
There was method in the architectural stratagems employed under Stalin. There was a manifest tendency towards hedged bets.
Here are buildings which appear to have been created in an attempt to avoid official disapproval by including as many officially approved motifs as possible. This is what is meant by designing for life.
Stalin exercised power for so long, not least because Stalinism was whatever he said it was, which is seldom what it had been yesterday or would be tomorrow. He ruled by murderous caprice and malevolent improvisation. He was a fleetfoot who flat-footed his rivals, and everyone around him was a potential pretender. Law upon law, he forges them as though they're mere horseshoes, wrote Mandelstam. In the psychopathic playground of the Kremlin, what was keenly sanctioned one week was a crime against the people the next. This applied to architectural aesthetics as to everything else. So the architect, the author, grants equal importance to every element. The subplots, so to speak, vie with the plot. The decorative footnotes dominate the structure to which they're appended. Ornamental parentheses expand across entire surfaces. This strange form of egalitarianism, probably the only form of egalitarianism to be practiced in the USSR, has its precedence in Art Nouveau and equally in 19th century academicism, not merely architectural academicism. Socialist realist painting, which is neither socialist nor realist, also derived from 19th century academicism, from a sort of painting decried as literary, which is a calumny on literature, and which is decried as bourgeois, which is a calumny on the bourgeoisie.
And it is, of course, accessible, visually accessible.
It had to be visually accessible. In the 30s, more than half the population was still illiterate.
The Soviets brought literacy to their empire so that new readers could learn of their achievements. But by giving people access to knowledge, a tyranny conspires in its own destruction. The greater the number of people that can read, the more thorough the controls that must be exercised over what they read. Of course, the earliest writing was an instrument of demagogic coercion, so the Soviets belonged to the most ancient tradition of state lies. The proletariat, as Stalin realized, responds to hyper-kitsch and is supposed to be grateful for it because it's literal, unambiguous, and it's invested with a single religious or religio's meaning. The subject matter of such painting is paramount. There must be a story or parable whose moral or message must be clear. There must be no ambiguity. There is no participatory engagement with the work. It's a one-sided compact. The passive spectator receives the straightforward message in a state of gratitude.
Thank you, Comrade Stalin, for a joyous life. Life is much merrier now. Thank you, it might be added, for obliging us to be happy. To be unhappy is to be an enemy of the state. Happiness is a duty. Therefore, we are happy.
Socialist realist paintings' other sources include the work of painters such as Jacques-Louis David, who had pandered to Napoleon's triumphalist narcissism. I wonder what Napoleon said when he crowned himself.
Vasily Yakovlev's rendering of Marshal Zhukov is sumptuously inane. This is the victor of the most mechanized war in history, and here he is in the flaming ruins of Berlin on a white charger.
The anachronism is laughable. The intended heroism is, unwittingly, mock heroism. The reversal of the swastika is formulaic superstition. Public architecture aspired to the same state as debased painting. That is, to be literary, to be read. The gestures derive from hagiographic Baroque statuary of the Counter-Reformation. The minimal difference is that the subjects are Stakhanovite tractor drivers and fecund collective farm girls, the saints of the new society, whose actual life was no doubt as miserable as that of Rome's saints, and whose death every bit is terrible.
The purpose of socialist realism was to proclaim the triumphant march of the revolution and to encourage that revolution, which would lead to further revolution, and thence onwards forever.
It was, of course, a lie. Fiction is a lie that tells the truth. Socialist realism is a lie that tells a further lie. It was institutionalized mendacity, removed from the subjects it purported to represent. The Soviet Union, after its first decade, was anything but revolutionary. It produced art and architecture which resisted change, let alone the chimera of progress. Its paramount characteristic, once it was established, was paralysis. Socialist realism's grip on reality was as frail as that of Norman Rockwell or reality television. Bad art for propaganda's sake. It is spin made stone, the organized social lie, as Kenneth Rexroth said of Woody Guthrie. The bigger it grew, the more extravagant its dimensions, the more apparent became its vacuity. Buildings, harvests, and expeditions were dreamed up solely in order that they could be gloriously represented. the Battle of Stalingrad was obviously not dreamt up. It was horribly real. The Soviet Union, our ally, suffered most and won the greatest of victories. It was the central, most crucial battle of the Second World War, the Great Patriotic War. And had the Red Army not prevailed, the consequences would have been unthinkable.
Its terrors and its heroism are captured on film and have been recreated in literature. But socialist realism cannot treat with the actual. Presented with an immense subject, its only response is to match epic valour and epic squalor with epic scale and epic emptiness. Millions of lost lives and the squalor of battle and its alleged glories are supposedly commemorated by this vast figure.
Mother Russia is meant to signify sacrifice and the indomitable spirit of the nation whose soldiers and civilians thwarted Nazism, and the military virtuosity of Zhukov, and the perspicacity of the great war leader Stalin, who did not actually visit the battle zone. Kitsch may be defined as the gulf between a professed, intended sentiment and the bloated expression of that sentiment. This is kitsch. Mother Russia is huge and void, lavish and arid. La Voix Sacrée at Verdun is profoundly affecting. So too is Lutyens's elegiac monument to the fallen of the Somme.
But this is merely a monument to monumentalism. It's not a conduit to remembrance. If, however, we ignore its purpose, what it's meant to be for, it is certainly one of the world's most spectacular freaks, a petrified, possibly transsexual, inflatable warrior doll, often mistaken by Western sex tourists for the memorial to the scorned mail-order bride. It shuns humility. It's mute about the battle's privations and degradations. Yet it says everything about the collective cast of mind that considers such a monument appropriate, that glorifies itself and glorifies war whilst pretending to glorify the dead, which treats ghosts and bones better than living beings.
It's axiomatic that the size and number of a regime's monuments are in direct proportion to the indignities suffered by that regime's subjects, just as the number of people in uniform is in direct proportion to a society's repressive uncouthness.
The cumulative effect of so much XXXL statuary is that exterior space becomes a sort of public gallery, a roofless museum of exhortation and bloated congratulation. It is the proletariat which is being congratulated. The proletariat knows, however, that its triumphant achievements are only made possible by the living God.
The living God, whose representation was everywhere, idealized representation. Stalin, the self-proclaimed man of steel, was as vain as an ingenue. This was a god who was a starlet that never ages. His raiments, calculated for immediate recognition, match his buildings. They grew ever more pompous, ever more imperial.
His fingers are bloated maggots. He leers through cockroach whiskers. He thinks with his bones. He feels with his brow. He tries to remember his human form. Mandelstam had the measure of him and would, as a consequence, die having been stripped of his human form. The tyrant reduces the persecutor to his level whilst maintaining the fiction that he is a benevolent pastor, wise teacher, generous father. Hence a strain of building which is carefully tainted with frivolity. Hence carrot buildings, infected with the mad gaiety of a fairground. A fairground, however, at which attendance is mandatory. The tyrant is also claimed to be the personification of the nation and of its law. Hence stick buildings, which are the law.
An agglomeration of whims. A bloated statute book turned to stone.
In the matter of the relationship between patron and architect, Stalin turned back the clock to an imprecisely pre-Renaissance time and to an imprecisely non-European place, to the storybook world of Akbar and Kublai Khan. He was like a deity of the steppes, with blood and yak butter on his hands and fermented mare's milk in his beard. A deity who decreed that his yurt must be replicated in marble. The brand new world that Joe built was a brand old world. As the dotard Stalin crept into murderous second childhood, so did the buildings he commissioned increasingly recall those of his distant infancy in the 19th century. The structural primacy that had given constructivism its name was overturned. Structure was disguised, hidden, buried beneath encrusted decoration, just as Stalin's deformed body was hidden and disguised by uniforms and retouching. Architecture became ornament. Ornament became architecture. All around buildings there was disposed abundant space, the better to display each ornament, to set it off like a jewel. A jewel is a token of wealth and power. Urban space is not passive. All absolutists have exploited its aggression. It's oppressive and threatening. Its paradox is that it incarcerates. It uses scale rather than manacles and chains. It diminishes mankind.
The fretting about the form that a non-capitalist Moscow might take was in practice resolved by its being partially transformed into a city of such vast spaces, voids of oppression, which are also happily apt for grandiose ceremonial, imperial pomp, martial theatre, for the staging of the state's narcissistic opera.
Its current character remains, 50 years on, indebted to Stalin, but hardly in the way which he foresaw. Moscow is a city that's akin to London. It changes at every corner. It changes style, changes scale, changes race, changes mood, changes purpose. Unlike Paris, it is architecturally marvelously impure. Unlike Rome, it does not offer a wearying diet of masterpieces. Far from it. Its vast, empty, melancholic, formerly imperious spaces are still vast, but full of larders and people, mostly larders, and the enticements of leaded petrol. Still imperious, though. A new city has squatted within the old. Stalin's statues are no longer here. The great airbrusher was himself airbrushed within a few years of his death. Khrushchev's denunciation of Stalin in 1956 was presaged just over a year earlier by his denunciation of ornamentalism, a sign of how much buildings were regarded as an expression of Stalin's will, of how much appearances mattered, and of how much Stalin's disappearance mattered to Khrushchev. But Stalin's metro, his buildings, and his 1935 arterial road plan are inescapable, and they're wonderfully contaminated, gleefully compromised. Stalin had no more idea than anyone else what a socialist city might be. Engels' equation of urbanism and capitalism was often wrong. In Moscow, however, it was predictively right. Stalin's Moscow was a stage waiting for the anarchy of capitalism to happen. There is nowhere in the world a greater Asiatic bazaar hoping to be taken for a European one. Trotsky, too, was wrong when he wrote of the proletariat's congenital incapacity to become a ruling class. Throughout the world, the proletariat has done just that, through consumerism. The proletariat rules us all. Its populist taste is universal law. Stalin may have turned a country into a council estate littered with death camps and monuments to his tyranny, but he's increasingly celebrated. The sentimental longing for the days of his leadership is shared over generations and social classes. The tiny minority of Germans who express a similar respect for Hitler in this way are subjects of obloquy.
Стали думать, что это выдающий человек, который со временем пройдет, и когда будет ставить ему памятники после страны. Хотя их сносили, а их поставят. Я чувствую, если у нас был бы сегодня такой руководитель государства, мы сегодня бы жили намного лучше. У нас было бы единое государство, которое было Советский Союз.
Революция!
Dispossessed and the ideologically right on, march under red flags waving pictures of Chairman Joe. They apparently yearn for an era when comradely enamel medals were awarded for super fertility and reaping feats, for digging and forging and grassing up your fellows. To live under the Soviets was to be at school forever.
Наша родина, Советский Союз. Я люблю ее и этим горжусь. За доллары не продаюсь. Советская милиция меня бережет. А что сейчас делается? Рвут на части родину мою, уничтожают наповал.
They exhibit a dissent which their hero would never have tolerated, but which the later liberal czars did, to their posthumous regret, no doubt. Had their secret police been as single-minded as the Cheka and the NKVD, Djugashvili would not have lived long enough to become Stalin, Ulyanov to become Lenin, Bronstein to become Trotsky. Never trust three pseudonymous moustaches.
Сталину просто вначале как религия, с детства, я родом из детства, как и все мы, вот, я вначале верил как религия. Потом я учился, работал и стал замначальником лаборатории, и у меня шло от религии к сознательному пониманию Сталина, роли Сталина. Это величайший, честнейший рыцарь 20 века, это честнейший человек в мире.
Communism is now a choice, which probably means that it isn't communism. Just as marching in honor of Stalin is not taboo, neither is building in his image. Again, 60 years on,
no German would contemplate mimicking Hitler's grandest style. But Joe Building is everywhere in Moscow. The architecture of purges, terror and genocide is stripped of its associations. It's just another style choice, served up in a spirit of willed forgetfulness.
But these buildings leave us in no doubt about the kind of architecture that betokens both the last truly powerful caste in Russia and the last proud moment in Russian history, the victory in the Great Patriotic War 6 decades ago, that often feels as if it was 6 weeks ago. Of all the buildings made in Russia since the Soviets' demise, none is so symbolically loaded and aesthetically questionable as the Cathedral of Christ the Saviour. This is a precisely detailed reconstruction of the cathedral which stood on this site and which was demolished to make way for the unbuilt Palace of the Soviets.
It's an immutable law of mankind that when one religion dies, those with an appetite for credulousness will seek out another.
Let's turn back the clock to a never time and a neverland where nothing changes, to the illusory solaces of stasis, to the illusory solaces of an older superstition,
which will, in the cyclical way of things, itself eventually be succeeded by a second coming. Thank you.